High Branch, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Continent Erupts, Decolonization, Civil War, and Massacre in Postwar Asia, 1945 to 1955, by Ronald H. Spector. Read by B.J. Harrison. Preface. The well-known essayist and novelist Pankaj Mishra recently declared decolonization to be the central event of the 20th century. He suggests that the first phase of this process took place during the years immediately following World War II, when anti-colonial movements across the world began to achieve their delayed victories. During the decade following the Japanese surrender, almost all of the countries of South, East, and Southeast Asia that formerly had been colonies of the European powers or conquests of the Japanese became independent nations. Whether or not this process constituted the central event of the 20th century, it was certainly among the bloodiest. 2 years after the end of World War II, Harold Isaacs, an American journalist in Asia, reported, "From one end of the vast continent to the other, it has seldom been possible since Japan's collapse to avoid the sound of continuing gunfire. There has been civil war in China, nationalist war in Indochina and Indonesia, rioting and mutiny in India, political collisions in Korea and the Philippines." Historian Priya Satya has observed that in explaining the origins and growth of the British Empire, it is impossible to factor the violence out. Similarly, in telling the story of the end of empire in Asia, it is also impossible to factor the violence out. East and Southeast Asia was, in fact, the most violent region of the globe during the decade following the end of World War II. In the course of their emancipation, the peoples of the former colonies and foreign-dominated areas split into rival factions and movements, all with claims to leadership and legitimacy in their new nations. A prolonged civil war engulfed China, a country still reeling from the wounds of its 7-year struggle against the Japanese. Similarly, Korea's liberation from 4 decades of Japanese rule was soon followed by a civil war that became an international conflict in 1950, marked by campaigns, weapons, and casualty rates comparable to those of World War II. The anti-colonial wars waged in Indochina and Indonesia also had many of the characteristics of civil wars, and in some areas resulted in a far larger number of deaths, particularly among the civilian population, than those experienced during the Second World War. No one can say with certainty how many died in these wars, but 2 respected demographers concluded in 2005 that the greatest battle violence of the past 50 years took place in China, Korea, and the Indochinese Peninsula. About 2,500,000 combatants lost their lives in the Chinese Civil War, about 800,000 in the Korean War, about 400,000 in the French War in Indochina, and at least 50,000 in the Indonesian War of Independence. These figures refer only to deaths among combatants. Estimates of the number of civilians who died vary greatly, but there is general agreement that they were much higher, perhaps 8 to 16 million in China, 5 million in the Korean War, and 300,000 in the Indonesian War of Independence. Except for the war in Korea, these conflicts are little known to American listeners. History textbooks often treat them as an aspect of the Cold War. Other authors see them as a chapter in the long narrative of decolonization, or, as Pankaj Mishra calls it, the interconnected struggles against white supremacy. A Continent Erupts aims to complicate those narratives by examining the characteristics, dynamics, and consequences of the military operations and other forms of mass violence during the decade following World War II in China, Indonesia, Korea, and Vietnam. While these wars have often been seen in terms of black and white, communists versus anti-communists, colonial powers versus anti-colonialists, and U.S. clients and allies versus Soviet clients and allies, this book suggests that these apparently black and white struggles may be more accurately viewed in various shades of technicolor. Instead of being simply wars of liberation or ideological contests, most of the conflicts in post-war Asia soon took on the character of civil wars, contests between and among the peoples of former colonial or foreign-dominated territories who held vastly different visions of their nation's post-colonial future. The character of these conflicts as civil wars also helps to explain the savagery of much of the fighting during this unsettled decade. In a conventional war, the opposing forces could be viewed simply as the enemy's army. But in a civil war, the opposing forces are often viewed as betrayers and oppressors of their nation. Such traitors had to be converted to the true cause or annihilated, crushed, not merely defeated. Far from being simply part of the struggle against white supremacy, the protagonists in this first decade of decolonization drew recruits from diverse racial and ethnic communities. In Indochina, for example, where French colonial authorities confronted Ho Chi Minh's Democratic Republic of Vietnam, often referred to as the Viet Minh, about 30% of the French Expeditionary Corps was made up of Vietnamese, Laotian, and Cambodian troops. Another 30% were colonial troops from West Africa and the Maghreb. Former Japanese Army soldiers were active on all sides of the Chinese Civil War and the wars in Indochina and Indonesia. Similarly, although most of the wars of decolonization coincided with the years during which growing Soviet-U.S. tensions hardened into the Cold War, none of these conflicts had their primary origin in Cold War rivalries. Instead, one, or often both, of the warring sides in Asia actively recruited the world's two 500-pound guerrillas, America and Russia, to intervene on behalf of their cause. As with any 500-pound guerrilla, their entrance inspired awe and fear. They thrashed about and caused a great deal of damage, but were seldom able to completely control the course of events. A Continent Erupts is primarily, though not entirely, a military history. It examines the nature and composition of the warring forces, their leadership, military effectiveness, strategy, and operational methods in the context of the political, social, and ideological forces influencing their behavior. It argues that whatever the larger historical significance of decolonization, its nature and duration was largely shaped by events on the battlefield, whether that battlefield was a clearly defined area of operations, as in the Wahai campaign, the Battle of Dien Bien Phu, or the Incheon landing, or was characterized by patterns of irregular warfare, terrorism, and massacre spread over entire provinces and regions. In his book, Bloodlands, Timothy Snyder analyzes the mass killings in certain areas of Eastern Europe, where Hitler's racist expansionism met Stalin's own deadly ambitions during World War II. Snyder points out that the highest number of civilian deaths often took place in areas such as Poland and the Baltic states, where cities and regions changed hands more than once in the course of political maneuvering or military operations. A similar pattern may be found in the wars of 1945 to 1955 in China, Indonesia, and Korea, where cities and towns often changed hands more than once. Seoul, for example, changed hands four times in less than 1 year during the Korean War. The city of Saping in Jilin Province changed hands three times during the Chinese Civil War. In addition to the catastrophic deaths and severe hardships inflicted on the residents by these repeated battles, each conquest and reconquest forced the inhabitants of these cities to choose sides, Those who chose one side unavoidably became vulnerable to reprisals by the opposing side when the city changed hands. This, together with their character as primarily civil wars, often fought with the level of firepower and intensity of World War II, helped to account for the deadly toll of the wars of decolonization and highlight the fact that in examining the story of Asia's liberation, as in the story of Asia's colonization, it is impossible to factor the violence out. Introduction. The Continent of Empire. In 1938, journalist John Gunther published Inside Asia. The book was a follow-up to his highly successful Inside Europe, which had introduced American readers to the politics and personalities of a continent increasingly shaped by the rise of fascism. Inside Asia was intended to serve as a similar analysis of what his publisher called the Continent of Mystery, providing all the average Western reader wants to know about Asia. Whether or not it was the Continent of Mystery, the Asia described by Gunther was certainly the Continent of Empire. Between the Persian Gulf and the Pacific Ocean, there were only three independent nations, and one of them was doing its best to swallow up the other two. The Empire of Japan seemed to many to be the Asian equal of fascist Germany and Italy in dynamism, ambition, and aggressive expansionism. Japan had first challenged the post-World War I international order in 1931 by seizing control of Manchuria. Manchuria, together with Korea, which Japan had forcibly annexed in 1905, was being developed by the Japanese as a model of modernity, industrialization, and rational planning, the answer to all of Japan's economic and social needs. The Manchurians, Mongolians, Chinese, and Koreans involved in the enterprise were expected to carry out their designated roles as part of a harmonious team under Japanese leadership and inspiration. Those who refused were dealt with swiftly and ruthlessly. Japanese expansion into Manchuria soon led to increased Japanese pressure on northern China, and by 1937, the Japanese were engaged in a full-scale war in China. By the time bookstores in New York were receiving their copies of Inside Asia, most of the largest cities of China had fallen to the Japanese. But the Chinese continued to resist. "This war," an American diplomat told Gunther, "will be permanent." The Japanese were the most fearsome and dynamic empire in Asia, but they were hardly the only one. Dominating the map of Asia was the Great Crescent of colonies and protectorates of the British Empire, stretching from India to Hong Kong. With close to 400 million people, India, Burma, Ceylon, and the Malay states produced much of the wealth of the British Empire in the form of rice, timber, rubber, oil, and tin. Malaya alone produced about 45% of the world's rubber and 35% of the world's tin. Southeast of Malaya, the Netherlands Indies, a vast archipelago of over 2,000 islands with over 65 million people, stretched east almost 3,000 miles to the Pacific Ocean. Even richer than Malaya in natural resources, the Indies had first attracted the Dutch because of its abundance of pepper, rice, and spices. In the 20th century, the islands also provided an enormous output of coffee, sugar, oil, iron, and rubber. France's empire in Asia, a collection of colonies and protectorates in Cambodia, Laos, and Vietnam that comprised French Indochina, was not so rich as the Indies, but still provided high-grade rubber for the Michelin tire factories, as well as coal, timber, coffee, and rice for export. A white man in the Orient can live a wonderfully easy life, an American army officer in China observed. For the most part, the Europeans in pre-war China and Southeast Asia did just that. Colonial life was very grand, recalled a former Life photojournalist in Indochina. He dressed in a white jacket and black trousers. They would all come dressed to the hilt, driving up in their Citroëns. Nobody worked very hard. All the finest imports were available. Caviar, French wines, and champagnes. A fantastically easy and gracious way of life because of the tremendous number of servants and the wealth they got out of the rubber plantations and the trading of rice and other businesses. Suhario Kachik Pamodiwirio, a student in the Netherlands Indies, recalled the elegant and fashionable boulevards of colonial Surabaya. Families used to take the cool evening air in elegant, horse-drawn carriages, the ladies and their chaperoned daughters on show, all decked in their finery, and passengers enjoying the welcome cool. The Simpang Club was a luxurious venue where tennis, billiards, dancing, and card nights were featured. The staff wore great uniforms, using Javanese headdress and colorful diagonal sashes. Except for parts of India and the Netherlands Indies, most of these colonial domains of the Europeans and the Japanese were less than 100 years old. The oldest Burmese, Koreans, and Vietnamese could still remember a time when their countries were at least partially independent. Attempts by the traditional rulers and governments in China, Korea, Vietnam, Burma, and other states to resist the encroachment of European rule during the 19th century had proven futile. But the close of the century saw the emergence of a new type of self-conscious, anti-colonialist nationalism in many parts of Asia. The political and intellectual leaders of these new nationalist movements, like Gandhi and Nehru in India, Sun Yat-sen in China, and Sukarno in the Netherlands Indies, were almost always Western-educated and often members of local elites. Many drew their inspiration from Japan, whose victory in the 1904 to 1905 Russo-Japanese War served as an inspiration to colonial people from Egypt to the Netherlands Indies. Here was an example of an Asian nation that the Americans and Europeans had attempted to bully into submission, as they had done with China. But the Japanese, through an astounding effort of self-strengthening, mass education, and industrialization, had retained their independence and emerged as a modern nation. The new anti-imperialist leaders lived in colonies that included a great variety of religious, linguistic, and ethnic communities. Nevertheless, these leaders saw their colonial territory as comprising a single nation, having its origins in an ancient period of national unity and greatness. Since then, the nation and its people had entered a long period of decline and forgetfulness, infinitely worsened by the arrival of the European oppressors. Many nationalists spoke of reawakening their past glories to help liberate their peoples. In Japan, the young samurai reformers, who had initiated the drastic transformation of their country using the Emperor Meiji as a symbol and figurehead, labeled their program a restoration. One of the remarkable developments of the present age has been the rediscovery of the past and of the nation, declared the great Indian political leader Jawaharlal Nehru. Much of this glorious past of unity and high civilization existed mainly in the minds of nationalist intellectuals, political leaders, and publicists. Along with the appeals to supposed common origins, traditions, and attachment to a common soil, the half-mythical glorious past formed an important part of the glue with which anti-colonialists hoped to bind divergent religious communities, tribes, and ethnic groups into a single nation. They were, as political scientist Benedict Anderson famously observed, imagined communities. Despite these growing movements of intellectual and practical resistance, the colonial empires of 1939 still appeared solid, unchanging, and unassailable, except perhaps by another colonial power. The European colonizers' mastery of scientific knowledge and technology, their sophisticated devices and machines, not to mention their military superiority, appeared to both justify and explain their hegemony over millions of less advanced peoples. A French colonial officer concluded that an error had been made by Lafayette and the other framers of the 1789 Declaration of the Rights of Man and of the Citizen. They should instead have written more modestly, the Declaration of French Citizen Rights. The Europeans' material superiority was widely believed to be a product of their national character, marked by rationality, discipline, scientific-mindedness, industriousness, and reliability. By contrast, Asians were generally perceived to be indolent, passive, devoted to tradition, superstitious, and unreliable. Virginia Thompson, an American academic expert on Southeast Asia, explained that the apathy, insensitivity, and placidity of the Annamites, or Vietnamese, was forced on them by climate and undernourishment, and they lack the driving force given by strong desires. Their intelligence is keen, but their character weak. One old Asia hand told John Gunther that among the natives of all Malaysia, including Siam, there were only half a dozen adults. The other natives were inept, slothful, lacking in push, and incredibly timid of accepting responsibility. Even in India, whose nationalist movement had caught the attention of the world as far back as the 1920s, many British colonials still insisted to Gunther that the Indians are incompetent, shiftless, supersensitive, bribable, and torn by religious fissures. They say that Indian capacity for self-government is a tremendous overstatement. The one exception to this pattern of native backwardness and European rule appeared to be the Philippines, which the United States had acquired from Spain in 1898 in a brief flush of boisterous overconfidence, patriotic ignorance, and geopolitical fantasy. After a short time, an American reaction against imperial adventures set in. It was encouraged by the experience of the bloody and protracted war against American rule that the Filipinos waged for over 3 years, and by resentment on the part of American sugar interests toward the preferential treatment granted to Philippine sugar. The 1916 Jones Act formally declared an American intention to grant eventual independence to the Philippines, and the Tidings-McDuffie Act, passed in 1934, provided for the establishment of self-government in the islands and set a 10-year date for independence. These American actions appeared to most foreign observers as merely the odd exception to the inexorable spread of empire and suggested to many Europeans that the Yankees lacked the dedication and perseverance necessary to carry out the civilizing mission. Then, in 1941, the entire edifice of European empire, built on racism and historical myth, bluff, bribery, tradition, and an increasingly feeble military capability, came crashing down. On December 7th to 8th, 1941, Japan struck simultaneously at Hong Kong and the Philippines and carried out a devastating raid on the U.S. Pacific Fleet at Pearl Harbor. 2 days later, the Prince of Wales and Renown, the only two British capital ships in the Far East, were sunk by Japanese planes off Malaya. In the weeks following Pearl Harbor, the Japanese rampaged through Southeast Asia, capturing Manila at the beginning of January and advancing down the Malay Peninsula to seize Singapore by mid-February. By then, Japanese forces had moved into the Netherlands Indies, and by late February, they had annihilated the British, Dutch, and American naval forces defending Java. Burma fell to the Japanese at the beginning of May, following a string of disastrous British military setbacks and costly retreats. By that time, the conquest of the Netherlands Indies had been completed. Corregidor, the last American outpost in the Philippines, fell on May 6, 1942. In the course of a few months, the Japanese had made themselves masters of an empire that rivaled that of Genghis Khan in size and extent. By a stroke more compelling than the fall of Malacca to the Portuguese in 1511, the balance of power between Europe and Asia seemed to have been immediately and permanently transformed. The cultural, social, and psychological consequences that accompanied this transformation were even more far-reaching. The European colonial masters, with their scientific knowledge, advanced technology, and superior efficiency, were suddenly shown to be toothless tigers, pathetic blunderers, all pomp and show, but helpless before the implacable and determined warriors of Japan. To Gay Wan Gay, a Singapore Chinese, the fall of Malaya proved that the British were not supermen as we used to think, and we remembered seeing them on the long marches to Changi Jail. It was a pitiful sight, and even the older people realized that white supremacy was a myth, that the Japanese had come and shown that Asians could come and overthrow the white authority. No Van Chieu, a Vietnamese high school student in 1940, recalled that many Indochinese people admired the French, despite their faults and their racism. They believed in the power of the French Empire. The early defeat of France by the Germans was hard to believe. Many people found it incomprehensible. Even more astounding was the supine way in which the French colonial authorities agreed, after only brief fighting, to convert Vietnam into a Japanese satellite in return for retaining their local prerogatives. The admiration and affinity that many former colonial subjects felt toward their Japanese liberators in 1941 to 42 was to prove short-lived, but their newfound disdain toward their former colonial masters was to prove permanent. Millions of former colonial subjects now found themselves participants in Japan's Greater East Asia Co-Prosperity Sphere. For some, Japanese rule brought opportunity. Thousands of lower-ranking native bureaucrats, technicians, policemen, and teachers now found themselves promoted to jobs previously reserved for Europeans. The changed landscape of political power inspired the emergence of new political movements, ambitions, and ideologies, as well as encouraging the renewal of older national, regional, and ethnic aspirations, quarrels, and rivalries. Some leaders, like Aung San of Burma and Sukarno of Indonesia, sought to further their cause by active cooperation with the Japanese. Others, like Ho Chi Minh's Viet Minh in Indochina, the Malayan People's Anti-Japanese Army in Malaya, and the Hooks in the Philippines, actually strengthened the appeal and cohesion of their movements by opposing the Japanese. In a few cases, Japanese-trained national militias, such as Aung San's Burma National Army and the Indonesian PETA, ended up turning against their Japanese sponsors. For the great majority of Asians, the co-prosperity sphere brought hardship, insecurity, and oppression. The large Chinese population of the Malay states and Singapore received especially cruel treatment. Several thousand were shot or drowned in mass executions during 1942. Many were arrested and tortured. Other groups were treated less harshly. But throughout Southeast Asia, no one was free from the attentions of the Kempeitai, the Japanese secret police, or from arbitrary confiscations, demands for labor, and the casual brutality of Japanese soldiers and officials. Malay villagers in Johor recalled that when passing a Japanese checkpoint, everyone had to bow to the sentries. The bow must be executed properly. If the guards were not satisfied, they would punish the people by having them stand in the hot sun or slapping them. Men from Burma, Indonesia, and other parts of Southeast Asia were ruthlessly conscripted for Japanese construction projects, such as the notorious Burma-Siam Railroad. 300,000 Indonesian forced laborers were sent for service throughout the Japanese Empire. Many never returned. Thousands of women were forcibly recruited for duty as captive prostitutes, or comfort women, to serve the Japanese military. Japanese mismanagement of the economy throughout their empire left a trail of hunger and privation. Everywhere in Japanese-ruled Asia, there was a catastrophic drop in rice production. Large-scale requisition of rice by the military in exchange for nearly worthless Japanese occupation currency discouraged rice farmers and encouraged hoarding. At the same time, the breakdown of local and international transportation left many farmers with no means to get their crops to market. Food shortages in some areas reached near famine proportions. Life became even harder in 1944 to 1945 after devastating Japanese defeats in the Marianas, the Philippines, and Burma. As they girded for the expected Allied attacks on the rest of their Asian empire, the Japanese tightened their rationing and stepped up their requisitions and conscription. The emperor's sailors and soldiers in Southeast Asia were expected to fight to the death as they had done in New Guinea, Saipan, Peleliu, and Iwo Jima. On August 12, 1945, Imperial General Headquarters had advised its overseas commanders that to continue the war with one mind is the only strategy for us, and each soldier should follow this spirit. Then, as suddenly as it had begun, the war with Japan was over. In the space of 1 week, American planes dropped atomic bombs on Hiroshima and Nagasaki, killing a total of at least 105,000 people. On the day before the second atomic bomb was employed, the Soviet Union declared war on Japan and attacked Manchuria across a broad front. Japanese military leaders and some cabinet ministers still wished to fight on, but the emperor intervened to direct that the government accept the terms of surrender issued by the Allies, following their summit meeting at Potsdam the previous month. On August 10, 1945, the Japanese Domei News Agency broadcast a statement by the Foreign Ministry announcing that Japan was prepared to accept the surrender terms offered by the Allies at Potsdam, provided that the said declaration does not compromise any demand which prejudices the prerogatives of His Majesty as a sovereign ruler. Washington's reply repeated the assurance offered at Potsdam that the ultimate form of government of Japan shall be established in accordance with the freely expressed will of the Japanese people, but specified that the authority of the emperor would be subject to the supreme Allied commander. In Tokyo, receipt of the Allied reply touched off a heated crisis within the small circle of high-level government leaders. The generals found the terms of the note intolerable and argued that Japan must fight on, whereas most civilian leaders called for acceptance of the Allied terms. With the government deadlocked, the emperor again intervened, announcing that it was his wish to accept the Allied reply as it stands. At 7 o'clock p.m. on August 14, 1945, President Truman announced to reporters jammed into his White House office that he had received from Tokyo a full acceptance of the Potsdam Declaration, which specifies the unconditional surrender of Japan. The following day, a brief radio address by the emperor announced the end of the war to millions of astounded Japanese all across the still vast empire, calling upon them to endure the unendurable and suffer the insufferable. Imperial princes were dispatched to the various outposts of the empire to ensure that military commanders complied with the emperor's instructions to cease hostilities. During August and September of 1945, forces of the victorious Allies moved to occupy all portions of Japan's former empire, where they would receive formal surrenders from various commands, and disarm and repatriate the Japanese. The basic surrender document, General Order No. 1, provided that Japanese forces in China, Taiwan, and northern Indochina were to surrender to Generalissimo Chiang Kai-shek, China's nominal wartime leader. All Japanese forces in Manchuria and Korea north of the 38th parallel were to surrender to the commander-in-chief of Soviet forces in the Far East. Japanese forces in Southeast Asia were to surrender to the Supreme Allied Commander Southeast Asia, Admiral Lord Louis Mountbatten, and those in other parts of the Pacific to Admiral Chester Nimitz, Commander-in-Chief Pacific. Japanese government leaders and armed forces in Japan and Japanese troops in the Philippines and Korea would surrender directly to General Douglas MacArthur. Except for the Soviets and MacArthur in the Philippines and Japan, most of the Allied forces were slow in arriving. In Southeast Asia, Mountbatten's forces arrived in southern Indochina only in mid-September, and in Java at the end of the month. The Chinese occupation of northern Vietnam began in mid-September. These delays gave the emerging nationalist political factions and movements in the former empires time to attempt to consolidate their positions and square off against each other. In Indochina, the Viet Minh, a coalition of nationalist and anti-French groups dominated by the Indochinese Communist Party, had been able to seize power in Hanoi and most of northern Vietnam with Japanese acquiescence by the end of August. On September 2nd, Viet Minh leader Ho Chi Minh formally proclaimed Vietnam's independence before a large crowd in Hanoi. Although support for the Viet Minh appeared overwhelming, they in fact faced strong opposition from some older nationalist parties. Their backing by Vietnam's large Catholic community in the north and two indigenous religious movements, the Hoa Hao and the Cao Dai in the south, was highly contingent and unreliable. Indonesia had declared its independence even earlier than Vietnam, and in southern Korea, the American occupation forces found a Korean People's Republic already in place and performing most governmental functions in many areas of the country. Both these new republics enjoyed widespread popularity, but there were rival factions and movements and plenty of fence-sitters. In Tokyo Bay, 280 Allied warships assembled on September 2nd to witness the Japanese surrender ceremony. Between 8 o'clock and 9 o'clock a.m., General Douglas MacArthur and other high-ranking officers came aboard the battleship Missouri to preside over the surrender proceedings. At its mainmast, the Missouri broke out 2 5-star flags, one on a red background for General MacArthur and one on a blue field for Admiral Nimitz, who was also aboard the battleship. The commander of the British Pacific Fleet, Admiral Sir Bruce Fraser, had provided a handsome mahogany table to hold the surrender documents. At the last moment, it was discovered that the mahogany table was not wide enough to hold the two documents when laid side by side. Captain Stuart Murray, the Missouri's commanding officer, dashed down to the wardroom with some sailors to grab a mess table. The mess table was bolted down, as it should be, of course, so we dashed down to the next compartment, the crew's mess compartment. Well, we grabbed the first table. The mess cooks were just cleaning it up. On the way to the wardroom, we knew we had to have a cover for that table, so I yanked the green tablecloth off the first wardroom table I came to and said to the guys on the deck to set up the mess table and spread the green cloth on it. It really looked very nice. Facing the small Japanese delegation across the table was a formation of Allied generals and admirals drawn up behind General MacArthur. Many of the defeated colonial figures were present. There was Lieutenant General Arthur Percival, who had surrendered in Malaya, Admiral C.E.L. Helfrich, who had narrowly escaped from the Netherlands Indies, and General Philippe Leclerc, a hero of the European War, who had been recently dispatched to try to pick up the pieces in French Indochina. Their presence could be taken as MacArthur's way of emphasizing the complete negation of Japan's earlier military triumphs, or as a way of signifying the determination of the dispossessed imperial powers to reclaim their colonial real estate. At the conclusion of the half-hour surrender ceremony, a formation of almost 2,000 American planes passed over the Missouri. If the defeated Japanese, British, Dutch, and French generals represented the imperial past, then those 2,000 planes represented the post-war present. Only the United States possessed the economic and military resources to decisively influence world events in distant Asia. The Soviet Union had an enormous army, which, after the defeat of Germany, now occupied half of Europe as well as northern Korea and a sizable slice of Manchuria. On the other hand, the Soviet economy was in a desperate state. Many of its industries were in ruins, and about 24 million Soviets had died in the war. By contrast, the U.S. gross national product had almost doubled during the war, and the nation had suffered only 419,000 casualties of all types, less than even Great Britain. U.S. industry had performed at such a rate that a great majority of Allied troops were armed with American weapons, rode around in American trucks, and flew American-made airplanes. In addition, American science and engineering had produced the atomic bomb. Hiroshima has shaken the whole world, concluded Soviet Premier Joseph Stalin. The balance has been destroyed. That cannot be. While the Soviets raced to right the balance by producing their own atomic bomb, the United States rapidly demobilized. 12 million men and women were in service at the end of the war, the vast majority of whom desired to return to civilian life as quickly as possible. This was especially true of those serving overseas. The logistical and administrative difficulties involved in transporting these forces back home quickly were immense, but GIs and their families were not disposed to hear about them. Bring the boys home became a universal demand. Congressman John Voorhees of Ohio called on the Joint Chiefs of Staff to allay suspicions that our armed forces are being held together so as to avoid a loss of rank by officers due to shrinkage of their commands. 20,000 GIs demonstrated in downtown Manila in January 1946 against what they saw as the slow pace of demobilization. Similar demonstrations occurred at American bases in Europe. Secretary of War Robert Patterson, on a tour of Pacific bases, was repeatedly booed and heckled by soldiers impatient with repeated delays and conflicting information. In fact, the pace of demobilization was remarkably rapid. In 8 months, from October 1945 to May 1946, American ships returned more than 2 million servicemen and women to the United States. Separation centers could complete all the paperwork to turn a GI into a civilian in less than 2 days. Altogether, about 5 million men had been discharged by early 1946, and many more soon followed. The size and structure of the armed forces shrank almost as rapidly as the number of personnel. The Navy abruptly canceled most contracts for new ships. About 7,000 vessels were declared war surplus, and an additional 2,000 were mothballed. The number of sailors on active duty shrank from about 3 million in August to less than 1 million in June 1946. The Marine Corps, which had had a strength of almost 500,000 on VJ Day, had fewer than 100,000 by 1946. Despite this rapid demobilization, or disintegration, as some of Truman's advisors called it, the United States remained the premier power in East Asia. In Japan, General MacArthur as Supreme Commander Allied Powers, or SCAP, exercised absolute authority, as did Lieutenant General John R. Hodge, who commanded U.S. occupation forces in southern Korea. Two Marine divisions were in northern China, helping to disarm and repatriate the Japanese, guard the rail lines, and some in Washington hoped deter further advances by the Soviets, whose troops held generous slices of Manchuria following their three-week war with Japan in August 1945. American shipping transported troops of Chiang Kai-shek's armies to northern China and Manchuria. American warships and planes returned to their old bases in China and the Philippines, as well as to newly acquired bases in Japan and the Ryukyu Islands. The warships of U.S. naval forces far east, although only a small remnant of Nimitz's immense armada of 1944 to 1945, nevertheless ruled the seas unchallenged. Yet beyond any military presence, it was the overwhelming economic strength of the United States and the post-war impoverishment of the old imperial powers, both victors and vanquished, that shaped the new international order. 1. We buried imperialism here today. The final act in the U.S. wartime mission in Asia appeared to come on a rainy morning on July 4, 1946, when the Philippines received its independence. It was independence with some strings attached. The Philippine economy was still closely tied to that of the United States, and the Americans retained large military and naval bases in the islands. Nevertheless, the occasion was greeted with enthusiasm by both Filipinos and Americans. In Manila, at 9 o'clock a.m., newly appointed ambassador to the Philippines, Paul V. McNutt, standing before a large crowd assembled in front of the imposing monument to Filipino patriot Jose Rizal, slowly lowered the American flag while bands played the Star-Spangled Banner. A few moments later, President Manuel Roxas raised the colors of the newly independent Philippines while the band played the national anthem. A parade of Filipino and U.S. soldiers wound through the streets, past buildings still scarred and bruised by the bitter fighting for the city between Japanese and American troops less than 2 years before, a battle that had left thousands of Filipino civilians dead. As the weather temporarily cleared, formations of planes passed overhead, while warships in the harbor fired a salute and church bells rang. Senator Millard Tidings, author of the Commonwealth Act, resplendent in a white sharkskin suit, gave an address, as did McNutt. But the star of the occasion was General Douglas MacArthur. Recalling the American promise of eventual independence for the Philippines, he declared, "America today redeems that pledge." The day's ceremony also marked the end of mastery over peoples by force alone, the end of empire as the political chain that binds the unwilling weak to the unyielding strong. Privately, MacArthur asserted that America buried imperialism here today. If imperialism had been buried on July 4, 1946, the death notice did not seem to have reached the rest of Southeast Asia. At the time of MacArthur's address, the French and Dutch were making a determined effort to reassert control in their former colonies. With few forces of their own in Asia, however, they were dependent on the cooperation of Southeast Asia Command, SEAC, an Allied headquarters established in mid-1943 under Admiral Lord Louis Mountbatten, to direct the war effort against the Japanese in Burma, Malaya, the Netherlands Indies, and parts of Indochina. SEAC's air, ground, and naval forces were mainly from Britain and countries of the British Commonwealth, primarily India. After the Japanese surrender, SEAC became responsible for the occupation of southern Indochina and the Netherlands Indies. Britain had a little problem with the desire of France and the Netherlands to reoccupy their former colonial real estate. Indeed, London had already concluded civil affairs agreements with both governments, which called for local administration to be handed over to the colonial authorities as soon as possible. On the other hand, the British were unhappy with their occupation tasks. Britain was teetering on the brink of bankruptcy. The newly installed Labour government was preoccupied with problems of the post-war transition and was under pressure to bring home the remaining British troops abroad. More than half of SEAC's troops would be units of the Indian Army, and India was facing its own problems as that country moved rapidly toward independence. Jawaharlal Nehru and other leaders of the dominant Indian National Congress Party sympathized with other independence movements in Asia. They saw no reason for Indian soldiers to be used to suppress the freedom struggles of other peoples. British authorities in India wanted their troops back as early as possible to deal with growing political and communal unrest in the subcontinent. Admiral Mountbatten and his staff had their own misgivings about the task ahead. A relative of the royal family, charismatic and ambitious, Mountbatten had no wish to see his public reputation suffer by association with the troubles and upheavals likely to occur when the French and Dutch colonials attempted to turn the clock back in Indochina and the Indies. "I think we should avoid at all costs the accusation that we are assisting the West to suppress the East," wrote Mountbatten's political advisor, Sir Esler Denning. "Such accusations will rise very readily to the lips of the Americans and Chinese and are likely to create an unfavorable impression throughout Asia." Major General Douglas Gracey, the commander of British occupation forces in southern Vietnam, appeared to embody Denning's worst fears. An Indian Army officer with little political experience and limited imagination, Gracey had arrived in Saigon with the 1st SEAC occupation forces on September 11, 1945. If southern Vietnam had a government at the time of Gracey's arrival, it was the newly established Provisional Executive Committee for the South, only four of whose 13 members were from the Viet Minh. The others represented the Trotskyites, the formerly pro-Japanese Phu Quoc Party, and two indigenous religious sects, the Cao Dai and the Hoa Hao, each of which had their own local governments and militias. These factions were often bitter rivals, but had united in an effort to present a united front to the British and French. Gracey completely ignored a delegation from the committee sent to welcome his plane at the airport, but he did work closely with the French. A few days after his arrival, the British commander issued a proclamation banning all demonstrations and processions by the Vietnamese. At the urging of French colonial officials, he also agreed to rearm French soldiers and sailors in the Saigon area, who had been disarmed and imprisoned by the Japanese, and allow them to reoccupy public buildings and government offices. On September 23, 1945, the French colonials promptly ousted the members of the provisional government from the treasury, the city hall, the police station, and various other public buildings, triumphantly raising the French flag over their reclaimed real estate. The French celebrated their success by going on a rampage, firing into empty buildings, assaulting Vietnamese at random, including women and children, and dragging many off to jail. Gracey was infuriated and ordered the French confined to their barracks, but the damage had been done. The clumsy and brutal French takeover united large segments of the heretofore quarrelsome and divided Vietnamese nationalists against the British and French. There were strikes, demonstrations, and sabotage. The food markets were burned out, shops and cafes closed, and many areas of the city lost their water supply. The Binh Suyen, a Vietnamese criminal syndicate, carried out a bloody raid on the Cité Héros, a residential suburb of Saigon that housed many well-to-do French and Eurasians, murdering more than 150 people, mostly women and children. From that point on, fighting was widespread around the Saigon area. Within a few days, many parts of the city were without food or electricity. Days appeared calm, but there was always the sound of gunfire during the nighttime hours. "Sniping is a nerve-wracking affair in the lightless city," wrote a reporter for the New York Daily Herald. "Shots may be fired from any building or doorway. Half-naked Annamites may suddenly whip out knife or gun from a loincloth." Gracie lacked sufficient forces to secure the Saigon area and break the virtual siege of the city by Vietnamese in the surrounding areas. Few French forces had yet arrived, and those on the scene had just demonstrated their unreliability. The best armed, best disciplined, and most numerous soldiers in southern Vietnam were those the British had come to disarm, the Japanese. Now, instead of being quickly repatriated, the Japanese units retained their weapons and were ordered to assist in patrolling Saigon and protecting food convoys to the city. In the course of combating the Vietnamese, the Japanese were to incur more than 400 casualties in only 3 months of fighting on behalf of their erstwhile enemies. By the beginning of October, Gracie had become convinced that it would be a good idea to talk to the Vietnamese after all. Urged on by Mountbatten's headquarters, he managed to arrange a ceasefire and a meeting between French representatives and Vietnamese leaders. The talks broke down after a few days because of the French inability to offer any firm commitments about independence, and fighting resumed after a week. By this point, Gracie had received reinforcements, including Spitfire fighters, and authorization to use them against Vietnamese roadblocks. General Leclerc, accompanied by elements of two French divisions with tanks and other heavy equipment, arrived during October, and the British, French, and Japanese took the offensive against the Vietnamese resistance. During November, as additional reinforcements poured in, the French re-established control of the main towns and roads in the provinces around Saigon and in the Mekong Delta. In January of 1946, the last SEAC forces were withdrawn from Vietnam. Gracie was made an honorary citizen of Saigon and warmly thanked by the French. Ho Chi Minh sent a new commander, Nguyen Binh, to the south to organize and direct resistance in the Saigon area. The Vietnamese forces, loosely led by the Viet Minh, withdrew to the swamps and jungles, where they established guerrilla bases for a war that was to continue for the next 8 years. Despite their unhappy experience with Indochina, SEAC planners initially had relatively few apprehensions about Indonesia. The Dutch were widely considered, even by the Americans, to be the world's most scientific, progressive, and efficient colonizers. Former Dutch colonial officials assured the British that the Indonesians, a docile and unsophisticated people, would be happy to return to the good old days. It seemed fantastic to the West to entrust the gentle, untrained peoples of the Indies with self-government, recalled American diplomat Charlton Ogburn. Better they occupy themselves with gamelan music and the Wayang dramas. The major challenges in the occupation of the Indies were expected to be disarming the Japanese forces in the islands, as well as liberating and assisting the thousands of Dutch, British, and other Allied prisoners of war and internees being held in scattered camps on Java. As in the case of Indochina, the British had concluded a civil affairs agreement with the Dutch at the end of 1944 that provided for a Netherlands Indies Civil Affairs Administration, NICA or NICA, to accompany or follow close behind the occupation forces and assume responsibility for any Dutch colonial territory recaptured from the Japanese. The Netherlands economy had been wrecked by the war and the German occupation. Dutch politicians, businessmen, and ordinary citizens looked forward to utilizing the wealth of their Asian colony to help rebuild their economy and recoup their losses. During the war, little information about developments in the Indies had been available to the Allies, and the Dutch imagined that the docile natives would welcome back their generous colonial masters. The Netherlands pushed for a speedy liberation of the Indies, reminding the Allies of their determined, if ineffective, defense against the Japanese in 1941 to 1942, and the subsequent contribution of Dutch shipping to the Allied campaigns in the Pacific. There was also growing concern about the fate of the more than 70,000 Allied prisoners and internees, many of whom were still living in miserable conditions in internment camps, where disease and malnutrition were rampant. At the same time, Mountbatten was also receiving reports that the Dutch might not receive the warm welcome they anticipated in Java and Sumatra. The war experience had profoundly changed the Dutch Indies. The Dutch colonial rulers were blown away as if they were grains of sand on a rock by the all-conquering Japanese, an Indonesian nationalist recalled in his autobiography. During the war, many nationalist leaders like Sukarno and Mohammed Hatta had cooperated with the Japanese and urged others to do so. Sukarno and Hatta had even been to Tokyo and received decorations from the emperor. Yet they were not simply opportunistic collaborators. They were widely acknowledged nationalist leaders of long standing who had spent time in Dutch prisons. They were also in secret touch with their pre-war associate, Sultan Siaurir, who had retired to his country home, claiming tuberculosis, but was actually occupied in organizing resistance to the Japanese. After installing themselves as absolute rulers of the Dutch Indies, the Japanese encouraged Indonesians to join officially sponsored mass organizations intended to mobilize labor and support for their rule and to indoctrinate Indonesians into hatred of the Dutch and the Allies, along with admiration for Japan's Greater East Asia co-prosperity sphere. The Indonesians had little trouble with the anti-Dutch part, but could not help noticing the wide gap between the lofty goals of Greater East Asia and the day-to-day conduct of the Japanese, who brought their own brand of casual cruelty and racism to the Indies. On Sumatra, newly arrived Japanese soldiers confiscated every bicycle they came across, as well as the wristwatches of the people they had just liberated. If anyone tried to resist, they received a kick or a punch. The Japanese wrecked the economy, created food shortages, and fueled inflation. The ubiquitous Kempe Tai, the Japanese military police, arrested and tortured anyone thought to be subversive or a spy. Indonesian women and girls were forced into service as comfort women, captive prostitutes for the military. About 200,000 Indonesians were also sent as volunteer laborers to all parts of the Japanese Empire. Many never returned. The combination of Japanese mass mobilization and Japanese oppression helped to politicize millions of Indonesian farmers, craftsmen, small businessmen, and clerks who, before the war, had no political affiliation or interests. As Japan's military fortunes worsened, the Japanese began to recruit and organize young Indonesians into various types of military and paramilitary organizations. The Heiho, way of the soldier in Japanese, organized in 1943, was a direct auxiliary of the Japanese army. Following their military training, its members served on all fronts of the Southwest Pacific, including the Philippines and New Guinea. The Pembela Tana Ayer, or PETA, Defenders of the Homeland, were intended to be a kind of national militia that would participate in the defense of the archipelago in the event of an Allied invasion. There was also a civilian vigilance corps, composed of air raid wardens, firefighters, and reserve police, as well as a women's auxiliary and a youth corps. Not all of these organizations were armed, but all received a degree of military training and were indoctrinated in the Japanese military ideals of unconditional loyalty, warrior spirit, and indifference to death. By mid-1944, as the Pacific War progressed from adverse to catastrophic for the Japanese, the imperial government in Tokyo began to speak seriously of independence for Indonesia. If Japan could not hold on to its Southeast Asian empire, it wished to leave behind independent and strongly anti-Western states to confront the returning allies. On August 9th, as American heavy bombers were completing their work of systematically burning down Japanese cities, Sukarno and Hatta flew to Saigon to meet with Field Marshal Heichi Terayuchi, the top commander in Southeast Asia, who confirmed the Japanese intention to grant independence to the Indies with the formal announcement set for early September. By the time Hatta and Sukarno arrived back in Jakarta on August 14th, clandestine shortwave radios were already carrying the news that Japan was about to surrender. At first, the two nationalist leaders reacted cautiously, but younger activists and a good many of their elders urged an immediate declaration of independence. At one point, a youthful group of nationalists kidnapped Sukarno and Hatta and demanded that they act. The two older revolutionaries were unintimidated by the young toughs, but were worried about the attitude of the Japanese on Java, which still retained their military capabilities. After receiving assurances from the local Japanese commander that he would not interfere with the declaration of independence, Sukarno and Hatta returned to Jakarta. Following an all-night meeting with a small group of Indonesian nationalist politicians and intellectuals, Sukarno emerged with a short, typed statement. "We, the people of Indonesia, hereby declare the independence of Indonesia. Matters relating to the transfer of power, etc., will be carried out in a conscientious manner and as speedily as possible. Members of the mass organizations, originally established by the Japanese to support Greater East Asia, quickly mobilized in support of independence and the newly proclaimed Republic of Indonesia. From cars, carts, windows, flagpoles, rooftops, and bicycles sprang up a forest of red and white flags of the new republic," recalled one British observer. Colonel K.K. Kennedy, the American military observer in Singapore, who visited Java in September and October 1945, reported that the feeling of nationalism had become so widespread throughout the Javanese population that the people as a whole could be aroused to resist Dutch rule and that none would support the Dutch. In what proved to be an accurate assessment of the coming Dutch-Indonesian conflict, Kennedy concluded that a fully equipped Dutch division could probably penetrate Java and proceed to wherever it wished to go, but that immediately after the army had passed a given point, the revolution would close in behind it. Providing armed support for the Republic was a collection of armed militias, urban gangs, and militarized youth groups. The most effective elements were men who had served in the Japanese-organized PETA militia, or in other military and paramilitary organizations. Veterans of PETA, along with former Heiho soldiers and former Indonesian members of the Netherlands Indies Army, the KNIL, formed the core of what would become the Republic's regular army, the Tentara Keamanan Rakyat, or TKR, People's Security Army, and later the Tentara Nasional Indonesia, or TNI, Indonesian National Army. When the PETA and the various paramilitary organizations were officially disbanded by the Japanese at the close of the war, many former members managed to retain their arms. Additional arms were obtained from the Japanese through bluff, bribery, or theft. Some Japanese officers, sympathetic to the Indonesian cause, helped nationalists obtain weapons. Other Japanese soldiers were not averse to selling or bartering a few rounds of ammunition or a rifle or two if the right deal was offered. In this manner, the Indonesian nationalists were able to acquire a formidable arsenal, estimated by one Japanese source to include about 50,000 rifles, 3,000 light and heavy machine guns, and 100 million rounds of ammunition. Mountbatten's forces would thus be facing not only an anti-colonial revolution with mass support, but a collection of well-armed, if not always well-organized or well-trained, militias, volunteers, and guerrilla forces determined to fight for independence. Lieutenant General Sir Philip Christison, commander, Allied Forces Netherlands, East Indies, considered Java a powder keg. He knew that Mountbatten and the government in London were unhappy with General Gracie's actions in Indochina and were determined not to have the experience repeated in Indonesia. Mountbatten told the senior Dutch representatives at Southeast Asia Command that British and Commonwealth troops would on no account be drawn into internal troubles on Java. The Secretary of State for War advised Christison that His Majesty's government are determined that nothing should be done to suggest that your troops are going to reimpose Dutch colonial rule. Shortly after his arrival in Batavia, or Jakarta, Christison held a press conference at which he announced his intention to meet with nationalist leaders and expressed regret that the Netherlands government had not done the same. This brought a strong protest from the Dutch, and Mountbatten cautioned Christison to be more circumspect. Yet whatever British intentions were, a clash with the Indonesians proved in the end impossible to avoid. This was the case for two reasons. The first was the British concern to safeguard and evacuate Allied POWs and internees located in scattered camps and towns throughout Java. This frequently brought them into collision with nationalist forces that often appeared hostile or threatening toward the Europeans, Eurasians, and others in the camps. Second, the British were committed to facilitate the work of the Netherlands Indies Civil Administration, NICA, and the return of the Dutch. Anticipation of the imminent return of the colonial authority brought on widespread anxiety, suspicion, anger, and resentment among Indonesians. Many were convinced that the Republic was in deadly danger. Rumors spread about the early arrival of Dutch troops. Spies in the pay of NICA were reported to be everywhere. This atmosphere of anxiety and suspicion formed the background to a period of prolonged violence, kidnapping, and individual and collective murders, later referred to by the Dutch as the Bersiap, get ready. The violence of the Bersiap period took the lives of at least 8,000 and possibly as many as 20,000 civilians in Java between October 1945 and late 1947. In addition to the Dutch, the suspicion of hostility of the nationalists was particularly directed against the Chinese community, who were attempting to remain neutral in the independence struggle, as well as the Ambonese, Christian Indonesians from the Maluku Islands east of Sulawesi. The large number of Eurasians called Indos, who spoke Dutch and wore European clothing, were also frequently singled out for violence. By September 1945, violence was widespread in many parts of Java. People began to disappear, most never to return. Others were attacked by roving gangs of youths and often hacked to pieces. Bodies floating in the rivers and canals became a common sight. Dutch colonials who had walked out of their internment camps after the Japanese surrender and managed to return to their houses in the cities now found themselves without water and electricity. Telephones ceased to work. Youth gangs, armed with long bamboo spears, patrolled the shops and markets, enforcing a self-proclaimed boycott against selling to Europeans. Servants were threatened with dire consequences unless they left the employ of the Dutch. Dutch and Eurasians were not the only targets of violence in Indonesia in 1945 to 1946. Indonesians in rural areas took their revenge against small or isolated groups of Japanese and against suspected Dutch collaborators. Chinese were frequently arrested and jailed. Others were assaulted, robbed, or murdered. In one district, not far from Jakarta, a local resident recalled that, in those days, it was difficult to find a drink of fresh water because most of the wells were stopped with the bodies of dead Chinese. Faced with the growing violence, many Dutch and Eurasians returned to the relative safety of their internment camps. They were joined by Chinese, Ambanese, and other ethnic groups who had been targets of revolutionary violence. These IFTUs, inhabitants friendly to us, in SIAC jargon, swelled the numbers in the camps well beyond their wartime population. The camps suffered from overcrowding, poor sanitary conditions, food shortages, and lack of medicine, and SIAC aimed to evacuate them as quickly as possible. Attempts to do this often led to problems with nationalist forces that controlled the nearby towns and access roads. As more and more Dutch soldiers and administrators arrived and tensions mounted, the nationalists often appeared to directly threaten the camps themselves. At the same time, British relations with the Republic deteriorated drastically after a clash between British forces and Indonesian fighters at the major port of Surabaya at the beginning of November 1945. In almost 3 weeks of intense fighting, entire areas of the city were destroyed. The Indonesians had obtained large supplies of arms, including artillery and anti-aircraft guns, from the Japanese. The British brought in tanks and aircraft. Two cruisers and three destroyers offshore provided naval gunfire support. Over 500 bombs were dropped on the city, and 90% of the population became refugees. The reports from Surabaya bear a sickening resemblance to the news from Warsaw, Belgrade, Rotterdam, Athens, Coventry, and London when they were subjected to the bombs of the Nazis, observed the St. Louis Post-Dispatch. The battle for Surabaya cost the Republic an estimated 7,000 casualties and left the British in command of the city, but it quickly became a symbol of Indonesians' determination and ability to fight for their freedom even against a modern military power like Britain. Surabaya was Indonesia's Lexington and Concord, and the anniversary of the battle is commemorated in that country as Heroes Day. News of events at Surabaya inflamed nationalists all over Java and led to additional fighting between Indonesians and SIAC forces. Major battles erupted around the large camps near Semarang on the Java Sea, Ambarwara in the mountains of central Java, and Magelang, not far from Yogyakarta. The Indonesian government had made some attempt to protect the camps in the first months after the Japanese surrender, but as fighting escalated, control of local governments and militias often passed into the hands of extremists who ignored admonitions from Sukarno's government. The independence struggle had long since attracted not only youthful patriots, but thugs, criminals, young men attracted by violence, older men with grudges, and freelance sadists of all backgrounds. Consequently, British attempts to protect and evacuate the camps were often accompanied by heavy fighting. Sometimes, SIAC garrisons near the towns came under siege. Relief convoys on the roads frequently became the target of snipers, mines, and even artillery. The British responded with airstrikes by fighter bombers and naval gunfire. During December 1945, when the Semarang area was described as fairly quiet, the cruiser HMS Norfolk still fired 140 high-explosive rounds in support of operations ashore during 1 6-day period. The Japanese were involved on both sides. Most Japanese soldiers, obeying British directions to protect the camps, fought alongside the British, Gurkha, and Indian troops. They did this so effectively that one Japanese officer was recommended by the local British commander for the Distinguished Service Order. A much smaller but significant number of Japanese cooperated with the Nationalists, providing them with arms, ammunition, and tactical training. Some Japanese fought alongside Indonesians in their battles with the British and Dutch. In 1953, the Japanese Repatriation Agency reported that at least 550 Japanese soldiers and civil servants in Java and Sumatra were known to have defected to the Nationalists and were still in Indonesia. The number of those who had died fighting the Dutch or British, or from other causes, was not known. Basing its conclusions on interviews with those who eventually returned to Japan, the Ministry of Foreign Affairs listed the four leading reasons for Japanese defections as fear of prosecution as a war criminal, loss of contact with their unit, connections with Indonesian women, and a desire to help achieve independence. Mr. Oshiro, for example, had been a cook in an infantry regiment. His job brought him into contact with many local Indonesians whom he met in the course of arranging and purchasing food supplies for his unit. At the conclusion of the war, they persuaded him to defect to the Nationalists. He did so, bringing along two machine guns and cases of grenades. Mr. Oshiro joined the army and served until independence, participating in the battles around Semarang and Bandung. On Sumatra, at the end of the war, Shigeo Miyayama, a young officer and graduate of Tokyo University, found that, "I could not just watch and stand by as the Indonesians resisted the return of white rule." During the war, he had found the treatment of the Indonesians by the Japanese disturbing. He guessed that the Japanese government must have promised the Indonesians independence. "Now, I watched the Japanese running away, but I couldn't just leave. I felt solidarity with oppressed peoples. I also liked the southern, laid-back lifestyle." Miyayama had been secretly reading nationalist pamphlets and newspapers, and so learned about fighting at Surabaya. "When I read about it," I thought, "the Japanese are now the running dogs of the British and Dutch." I considered that as the beginning of my own revolution. Miyayama found it difficult at first to join the Nationalists because they were suspicious of Japanese officers. However, the local Indonesian forces were in need of someone who could train their soldiers in the use of trench mortars. Miyayama was able to slip away from his base, escorted by seven distrustful Indonesian soldiers. He served for 4 years with the Indonesian forces before returning to Japan. For a time, Miyayama's unit was commanded by Mr. Shima, who Miyayama guessed was a graduate of the Nakano School, the Japanese Army's school for intelligence and special operations. He had the characteristics of a fanatic right-winger, but still many soldiers liked him. Shima was very knowledgeable about making explosive devices from leftover Japanese ordnance. He also provided guerrilla warfare training to the Nationalists and started a school for non-commissioned officers. Mr. Shima was accidentally killed while rigging a grenade booby trap, but stories of his supposed heroic death circulated among the Achenese of western Sumatra for a number of years. By the end of 1945, pressures were mounting on the British to wind up their sojourn in the Indies as early as possible. There was widespread concern over the casualties to British and Indian troops. Questions were raised in Parliament. Indian National Congress leader Jawaharlal Nehru was reportedly so concerned about the situation that he considered making a personal visit to Java. News stories about Dutch and Japanese troops riding around in American Lend-Lease trucks and tanks, still bearing their U.S. markings, angered American readers and prompted a formal protest from the State Department. The Soviets brought up the question of Indonesia in the United Nations and called on the Security Council to intervene. British generals worried about the morale of troops who had already fought through one long war and were now committed to a new one after peace had been declared. Admiral Mountbatten observed, "Both by the press and by letters from home, British troops are being made to believe that the imposition of Dutch authority by force of British arms is a wrong cause. They do not like fighting for this, although they are quite ready to fight to secure the safety of European and Eurasian women and children." Then, in November of 1945, the hard-pressed British received some welcome news. A new Indonesian government took office, headed by Syahrir as Prime Minister and Minister of Foreign Affairs, with his close associate Amir Sharifuddin as Minister of Defense and Information. Sukarno remained as president. Sukarno had often been labeled by the Dutch as simply a Japanese collaborator. But Syahrir had avoided even the appearance of collaboration during the occupation. Sharifuddin's credentials were even more impeccable. He had actually been imprisoned by the Japanese. With the cooperation of the new government, Christensen was able to arrange for the evacuation of the remaining Dutch and Allied internees from the interior camps to British or Dutch-controlled areas. At the same time, talks began between Sukarno and Dr. Hubertus von Mook, head of NICA and chief Netherlands representative in Java. The talks led nowhere, but the British government, now determined to escape the Indonesia quagmire, transferred General Christensen, who had alienated the Dutch with his ill-concealed contempt for the conduct of their colonial troops, to an important command in Europe. An experienced diplomat, Sir Archibald Clark Kerr, was appointed to help facilitate negotiations between the Indonesians and Dutch. Talks between the Dutch and the Syahrir government dragged on through the first quarter of 1946, with the Netherlands offering little beyond a new scheme for a commonwealth of the colonies of Curaçao, the Indies, and Suriname. After a given preparatory period, the citizens of the colonies would have the right to determine their constitutional destiny. Nothing was said about the independence of Indonesia. Meanwhile, 9 battalions of Dutch Marines came ashore at Batavia and Samarang. Some still wore the American uniforms and insignia they had received during their training at the U.S. Marine base at Quantico, in anticipation of an Allied invasion of Japan. How much training the Dutch had actually absorbed in the United States was a matter of conjecture, but British observers agreed that they had thoroughly assimilated the American habit of constant gum-chewing. In March 1946, Syahrir and von Mook reached a tentative agreement in which the Dutch would recognize the Republic of Indonesia, headed by Sukarno, as the de facto government in the areas it controlled on Java and Sumatra. The Republic would agree to join an Indonesian federation organized by the Dutch. Further negotiations about this plan were supposed to take place in The Hague, but when the Indonesian representatives arrived in the Netherlands, they found the country in the midst of an election, with none of the major parties willing to risk the appearance of making concessions on the Indies. After a week of fruitless discussions, the Indonesians returned home. While the Dutch Republican talks had been proceeding, SEAC had begun concentrating the remaining Japanese troops on Java, in Batavia and Surabaya, for repatriation back to Japan. By June 1946, all had returned home, followed by the Japanese troops from Sumatra during the summer. Mountbatten concluded an understanding with the Dutch, giving them a free hand to call in all the additional troops they wished and carry out operations anywhere outside the narrowly demarcated areas still held by the British. Mountbatten made clear that his forces would not be available to provide military support anywhere outside those areas after June of 1946. The last British troops left Indonesia in November of 1946. The Dutch viewed their departure without regret, confident that they could quickly re-establish their authority now that outsiders like the Japanese and British were gone, and the Royal Netherlands Indies Army, with its American weapons and equipment, had finally arrived in force. Before their complete withdrawal, the British had insisted on some form of agreement between the Dutch and the Republic. Following a ceasefire in October 1946, negotiations began in November in a large colonial mansion in the pleasant hill town of Linggadjati in central Java. On November 12th, Van Mook and Shahrir concluded an accord. In the Linggadjati Agreement, the Dutch recognized the authority of the Republic in Java, Madura, and Sumatra. Both parties agreed to work toward the eventual creation, by 1949, of a United States of Indonesia, with the Republic as a constituent state and the Queen of the Netherlands as the head of a union of all the former Dutch colonies. Neither side was happy with the agreement, nor trusted the other to really abide by its terms. In contrast to the widespread violence and disorder in southern Vietnam and Indonesia, the Chinese occupation of northern Vietnam was remarkably peaceful and orderly. Chiang Kai-shek assigned the Yunnan warlord General Lu Han to direct the occupation of the north. Most of Lu Han's troops were scheduled for early redeployment to northern China and Manchuria, where they would be needed in the anticipated confrontation with the Chinese communists. Unlike their British and Dutch counterparts, French colonials in Vietnam had not been obliged to forfeit their comfortable lifestyles when Indochina came under the sway of Greater East Asia. Feeling militarily vulnerable and encouraged by Vichy to cooperate, the French colonial authorities had made progressively greater concessions to the Japanese, allowing them to station troops in Indochina and to use the ports, railroads, and airfields. In return for French acquiescence in this de facto occupation, the Japanese allowed the French colonial government, headed by Admiral Jean Décou, to remain in place and carry on most of its day-to-day functions. The French flag still flew over Hanoi, Haiphong, and Saigon. French colonial police patrolled the streets, and colonial society still gathered in the cafes. But 50,000 Japanese troops garrisoned the country. Japanese planes flew from the airfields, and the Japanese Navy established a base at Cam Ranh Bay. This convenient arrangement continued until March of 1945. By that point, the Japanese had become increasingly concerned about the possibility of an Allied invasion of Indochina. They were also aware that the French colonials, at the urging of General Charles de Gaulle's newly installed government in Paris, were busily reinventing themselves as an anti-Japanese maquis to impress the Allies. On March 9, 1945, the Japanese moved suddenly against French garrisons and forts all over Indochina. A few French soldiers offered brief resistance, but most were quickly disarmed, and many French soldiers, police, and colonial functionaries found themselves locked up in their own jails. With the French deposed, the Japanese called upon the hereditary emperor of Vietnam, Bao Dai, to form a government for independent Vietnam. Bao Dai's government, headed by Prime Minister Tran Trong Kim, had no popular following and little real power. But the disappearance of the French security apparatus and the preoccupation of the Japanese with preparing for the anticipated invasion provided an opportunity for more ambitious political groups to organize and expand. The best positioned of these organizations was the Viet Minh, a coalition of nationalist and anti-French groups dominated by the Indochinese Communist Party. Its leader was Ho Chi Minh, a veteran revolutionary who had battled French colonialism for decades. A founding member of the French Communist Party, Ho had trained in Moscow during the 1920s and guided the establishment of a communist organization in Vietnam during the 1930s. A man of great personal charm and magnetism, he combined tenacity of purpose with flexibility in action. With the Japanese takeover, the Viet Minh saw their opportunity. Viet Minh propaganda teams, proclamations, and underground newspapers told the people that the Japanese were now the major enemy and would be vanquished like the French. Vietnamese soldiers of the former French colonial army and militia were encouraged to defect to the Viet Minh. Government officials, educators, and professionals in northern Vietnam secretly began to align with the Viet Minh. Mass front groups, such as the Women's National Salvation League and the Peasants' Salvation Association, were quickly established. During the spring and summer of 1945, a devastating famine, caused by bad harvests and requisitions by the Japanese military, swept through northern Vietnam. The Viet Minh saw the famine as an opportunity to organize to seize the rice granaries of the colonial regime and direct popular resentment and anger against the French and Japanese. Besides their success in infiltrating and mobilizing the population, the Viet Minh benefited from a unique advantage among Vietnamese nationalists: their association with the victorious Allies. Since 1944, the Viet Minh had been involved in the recovery and rescue of American aviators whose planes had been brought down over Indochina. After the Japanese takeover in March, the Viet Minh became the sole source of reliable intelligence for the Allies. In July 1945, the OSS Chief of Intelligence for Indochina, Major Archimedes L. Patty, met with Ho Chi Minh and agreed to send an OSS training team to arm and train the Viet Minh for guerrilla operations against the Japanese. When news of the Japanese surrender reached the north, the Viet Minh were ready. Within a few days, most of northern Vietnam, Tonkin, and a large portion of Annam in the center were in the hands of the Viet Minh. Emperor Bao Dai abdicated in favor of the new government, and the Japanese remained discreetly in the background, handing over responsibility for police, public order, and utilities to the new regime. On Sunday, September 2nd, a crowd swollen to 300,000 or 400,000 by arrivals from the countryside gathered in Ba Dien Square near the former Governor General's Palace in Hanoi to hear Ho Chi Minh read Vietnam's Declaration of Independence. The Viet Minh knew that their new regime was in a race against time. Chinese occupation troops would arrive in a few weeks. The French were determined to regain control of their colony. The attitude of the Allies was uncertain. Widespread starvation remained a threat. Rival nationalist and anti-colonial groups, like the Vietnam Quoc Dan Dang, VNQDD, or Vietnamese Nationalist Party, the formerly pro-Japanese Dai Viet, and the Chinese-backed Dong Minh Hoi, were in temporary eclipse due to the Viet Minh's superior organization and its association with the Americans. But these groups retained a large following, together with their own newspapers, radio stations, and armed militias. The Viet Minh government did what it could to eliminate its opponents. Hundreds of nationalists were tried as counter-revolutionaries or disappeared into the hands of specially formed honor squads for the elimination of traitors. Ngo Van Chieu, who had joined the Viet Minh in the spring of 1945, was in charge of soliciting contributions from wealthy Hanoi Vietnamese to help support Ho's new government. Potential beneficiaries who hesitated to contribute were imprisoned by the militia. Their wives were then notified that their husbands were sick and that they needed to pay 500 piastres a day to help restore their health. Prominent members of Bao Dai's government were executed at the time of the emperor's abdication. Decrees issued on September 5th and 12th outlined the Quoc Dan Dang Party and the Dai Viet. Yet the Viet Minh could not go too far, since some of its rivals, especially the Dong Minh Hoi, had close ties to the Chinese. General Lu Han's occupation army advanced slowly into Indochina and did not reach Hanoi until September 14, 1945. All day and all night, the troops kept pouring into the city, recalled one Vietnamese observer. They shocked everyone, including the local Chinese community, which had organized a formal welcoming committee for them. The troops wore shoes of woven straw cloth or rubber, cut out from tires, or even went barefoot. They had tattered uniforms and looked tired and thin. Each unit was accompanied by cooks, laden with pots and pans, making a racket. Accompanying Lu Han were American liaison teams of the Chinese Combat Command, an American military advisory organization that had been training Chinese troops in southern China when the war ended. The teams were under the command of Brigadier General Philip E. Gallagher, Lu Han's advisor. Major Patti was already in Hanoi with a small OSS team and had witnessed the independence ceremony. Ho treated Patti as a confidant and addressed messages through him to Washington, appealing for U.S. support of Vietnam's independence. Although the presence of these Americans in Hanoi appeared to be evidence of high-level interest in the fate of Indochina, their actual assignments were far more prosaic. In the case of Patti's OSS team, the principal mission, in addition to collecting general intelligence on Indochina, was to locate and assist Allied prisoners of war and internees, investigate war criminals, and assist in preparations for the surrender and disarmament of Japanese forces. General Gallagher's orders limited him to advising and assisting the Chinese central government military forces during their movement to their areas of occupation, and providing necessary supplies and support. The United States had never had a clearly defined policy toward Indochina, although President Roosevelt had been outspokenly critical of colonialism in his private comments and discussions. With his death in April 1945, the United States virtually ceased to take any active role in discussions of Indochina's future. Nevertheless, many Vietnamese viewed the handful of Americans in Hanoi as a symbol of support for their independence, while the French viewed the Americans with suspicion as part of a conspiracy to displace them in Vietnam. Colonel Jean Santeny, de Gaulle's representative in Hanoi, reported that the role of mediator in this conflict has been conveniently assumed by the Americans, who are especially interested in establishing future commercial relations. The French expected to be treated as one of the victorious allies in Asia, just as they had been in Europe. Never mind that the French colonial regime had collaborated with the Japanese for almost 5 years. The de Gaulle government insisted that the brief, disorganized response to the Japanese coup of March 1945 constituted resistance, and France had a right to expect its allies to help it regain its rightful position. The Chinese were little inclined to cooperate. Lu Han was no Patton, and his army may have lacked spit and polish, but he knew a good deal when he saw one. Hanoi was virtually undamaged by the war. Its shops, businesses, and small manufacturers were still intact. The French-owned Bank of Indochina held thousands of piastres. The French garrison was still locked in the citadel, an 18th-century fortress to which the Japanese had confined them after the March takeover. Ignoring French protests and demands, the Chinese quickly came to a working agreement with Ho. French soldiers remained locked in the citadel. The Viet Minh were not disarmed. Ho was pressured but not compelled to include members of the Chinese-supported nationalist parties in his government. The price paid by the Viet Minh for this arrangement was high. The entire cost of the Chinese occupation forces in the north was to be borne by the Vietnamese, to be compensated later at a fair rate of exchange. The exchange rate between the almost worthless Chinese dollar and the Vietnamese piastre was arbitrarily set at 14 to 1, thus making the Chinese dollar worth 3 times more in Vietnam than in southern China. millions of Chinese dollars began to arrive in Indochina. In one instance, $60 million was reported on a single flight from Kunming. Luhan's officers, Major Patti recalled, quickly organized themselves into tightly knit syndicates to buy out, at ridiculously low cost, every profitable enterprise they could. Front companies and trusts were quickly formed to acquire outright ownership of or controlling interests in Vietnamese or French-owned plantations, farmland, buildings, mines, and factories. Even the small merchant was not spared. If they protested or dared to resist any offer made by the syndicate, the military had ways to persuade. With their bargain shopping and other business activities, the Chinese, according to one estimate, managed to extract some 400 million piastres from the poorer half of a country whose total gross national product in 1939 had been 1.1 billion piastres. In return for these concessions, the Chinese dealt with the Viet Minh as the de facto government of Vietnam. Many Chinese officers had long-standing grudges against the French and were in no hurry to see them returned to power. When the French government sent General Marcel Alessandri as the official representative to the Japanese surrender ceremony, Luhan refused to allow him to participate because of his unclear position. Nor would the Chinese general allow the French flag to be flown with those of the other allied nations. Yet while Luhan and his generals were happy to give the back of their hand to the French in Hanoi, Chiang Kai-shek's government was more than willing to negotiate a return of the French to northern Indochina in exchange for the surrender of the last remaining French concessions and special privileges in China. On January 8, 1946, the French and Chinese governments officially opened talks on the withdrawal of Chinese troops. Since October, Ho and Santini had been meeting for secret talks in a villa off Paul Bert Square in central Hanoi. Santini was accompanied by Leon Pignon, a veteran colonial bureaucrat, and Ho by Wong Min Jiam, the Minister of Culture. Santini recalled that while he talked, Ho smoked continually. Chinese cigarettes, American cigarettes, and the strong Gauloise cigarettes. Pignon smoked even more. Our talks ended late at night, in an atmosphere as thick with smoke as an opium den, but without the euphoria. The talks took on added urgency when the French negotiations with the Chinese government became known, and as the French assembled an invasion force in the south to reoccupy northern Vietnam. The main point of contention in the talks was Ho's insistence on explicit French recognition of Vietnam's independence and unity. While the talks dragged on, Ho took what steps he could to strengthen the Viet Minh's position. The Indochina Communist Party was officially disbanded, to be replaced by a Marxist study group, through which the party continued to function. To placate the Chinese and broaden popular support, Ho opened talks with the opposition nationalist parties for a broad coalition government, with elections to be held in January, and with the VNQDD guaranteed 50 seats and the Dai Viet 20 seats in the new 350-delegate National Assembly. The Viet Minh swept the subsequent elections. No voting took place in provinces such as Vinh Yen, Viet Tri, Yen Bay, and Lang Son, where the nationalist parties predominated. But the Viet Minh candidates for these areas were nevertheless declared winners as well. Altogether, the Viet Minh won 300 of the 350 seats, or 280, after the VNQDD and Dai Viet had received their guaranteed quota. The national elections gave prestige and legitimacy to the Viet Minh and enabled them to represent themselves as the authentic representatives of the Vietnamese people. Having prevailed in the elections, the Viet Minh turned to neutralizing their Vietnamese opposition. Some of the opposition nationalist parties enjoyed the support of the Chinese. They also controlled an articulate and influential press, including two leading newspapers that regularly attacked and denounced the deeds of Ho's government and accused it of readiness to compromise with the French. The VNQDD also operated its own radio station. Yet the parties were not united, and all proved vulnerable to infiltration and disruption by the Viet Minh, who controlled the municipal police and the security services in the large cities and many parts of the provinces. The armed forces and the militia were also firmly under Viet Minh control. These organizations were used to control and disrupt nationalist activities and to infiltrate their leadership. Nationalists who appeared susceptible were pressured to defect to the Viet Minh through persuasion and propaganda, family pressure, blackmail, kidnapping, or torture. One of Ho's favorite tricks was to catch opposition elements with counterfeit money, recalled the American vice consul at Hanoi, James O'Sullivan. Everybody had counterfeit money because that's something the Chinese do well. If Ho's men picked up somebody, he'd always be carrying counterfeit money. Or you'd read in the newspapers that the two Ve, militia, had raided some Kwok Dun Dang place and found counterfeit piastres. Then maybe they dug around and claimed they'd found skeletons. It was part of a consistent pattern of eliminating the opposition. These guys would be arrested and disappear. Outside the cities, the nationalists fought back with some success, but were handicapped by disunity and lack of coordination. Their support from the Chinese was unchangeable and uncertain, while at the same time, the French began to look on the Viet Minh as a faction with which they might make a deal. "Thank goodness Ho Chi Minh is the boss," wrote one French general. "He wants to get rid of the VNQDD, which can only aid our cause." Santani observed that while Ho's nationalist rivals demanded total and immediate independence as a condition of any negotiations, Ho seemed to be more reasonable. On February 2, 1946, the French and Chinese governments finalized their agreement on the relief of the Chinese occupation troops by the French. A French expeditionary corps under General Leclerc was already on its way north by sea. Yet Ho and Santani still had reached no agreement. Finally, in the early morning hours of March 6th, as the expeditionary corps prepared to land, the two concluded a deal. France recognized the Republic of Vietnam as a free state, having its own parliament, army, and finances. Questions concerning the unification of the three parts of Vietnam were to be settled by popular referendum. In return, the government of Vietnam agreed to amicably welcome the French army when it arrived to relieve the Chinese troops. On March 18, 1946, General Leclerc led a long column of trucks carrying the troops of the French 2nd Armored Division in a parade through central Hanoi. French residents of Hanoi, who thought the city had been liberated, lined the parade route, cheering enthusiastically. What they did not realize, observed OSS cryptographer George Wicks, is that it cost Leclerc considerable face before he was allowed to enter the city with a guard of honor of 1,000 troops. 1 week later, Ho met with Admiral Thierry d'Argentleu, High Commissioner for Indochina, aboard a French cruiser in Ha Long Bay. A former Catholic monk, as well as a naval officer, d'Argentleu was a fervent disciple of de Gaulle. In politics, he stood slightly to the right of Louis XIV. Personally, he was imperious, grandiose, and implacably stubborn. During World War II, he had inspired homicidal thoughts among the American officers, who had the misfortune to have to deal with him as Free French Governor of New Caledonia. In a remark that was soon to become famous, d'Argentleu declared, "I am amazed, yes, that is the word, I am amazed that France has such a fine expeditionary corps, and yet its leaders would rather negotiate than fight. It took only a few hours of conversation with the admiral to convince Ho that any real progress would have to come from direct negotiations with the French government in Paris. Leclerc and Santani agreed with Ho's insistence on direct talks, and on April 30th, Ho and a Vietnamese delegation boarded a French airplane for the long journey to France. After a few days' rest at Santani's villa at Biarritz, Ho went to Paris, where he gave interviews, attended receptions, and drew large crowds of onlookers. The talks themselves soon bogged down. The unstable and changing French cabinets could give them little attention, leaving the actual negotiations to old hands of the colonial ministry. In addition, D'Argentlieu did his best to sabotage the entire process by unilaterally organizing an Autonomous Republic of Cochin China, then calling a conference of representatives from Annam, Cochin China, Laos, and Cambodia to discuss a future Indo-Chinese federation. When the French representatives in Paris refused either to set a firm date for a referendum on Cochin China or explicitly recognize Vietnam's independence, the Vietnamese delegation broke off the talks and returned home. Ho remained behind in Paris and succeeded in negotiating a modus vivendi with Marius Moutet, the colonial minister, on September 15th. The modus vivendi reaffirmed the March agreement and called for a ceasefire in southern Vietnam and a second round of negotiations in Paris in January. At 4 o'clock p.m. on October 20, 1946, the sloop Dumont d'Urville steamed into Haiphong Harbor, flying the red flag with gold star of the Democratic Republic of Vietnam next to the French tricolor on its mast. The ship sounded a long blast from its siren and was answered a few moments later by a siren blast from the municipal theater. Ho Chi Minh stepped ashore to be met by French and Vietnamese dignitaries and an honor guard, while a band played the Vietnamese and French national anthems. Pham Quang Le, a young engineer from France who had accompanied Ho back to Vietnam, found the situation very tense. The French colonialists had gone back on their undertakings. The people were in a fighting mood. They hated the enemy and were ready to die for their country, though insufficiently armed. While the negotiations had proceeded in Paris, the Viet Minh at home had taken advantage of the departure of the Chinese to complete the destruction of the rival nationalist parties. Nationalist groups such as the Coq Dan Dang, the Dong Minh Hoi, and the Dai Viet still had considerable forces and held some important towns, but the factions, even when they were not fighting one another, seldom cooperated or coordinated their efforts. The Viet Minh forces were better armed and disciplined, and they had the acquiescence and sometimes the support of the French, who were happy to see the defeat of the nationalist parties, which they regarded as more dangerous than the Viet Minh. A French report noted that the Viet Minh were able to eliminate the parties of the opposition who were hindering their efforts, thanks to our indifference and, in some cases, our aid. Between June and November 1946, Viet Minh forces seized nationalist strongholds at Viet Tri, Lao Cai, Lang Son, and Phu Yen. Some nationalist adherents retreated to southern China. Others were converted to the cause or executed. The Nationalist Assembly convened at the end of October and approved a new cabinet in which Viet Minh ministers occupied all key positions. Ho was named prime minister as well as president. A draft constitution that declared the complete independence of Vietnam without reference to the French Union was approved 2 weeks later. By then, there had already been trouble with the French. At the port of Haiphong, the French had continued to behave as if they were in total control, ignoring Vietnamese customs authorities and stopping shipping they believed to be carrying smuggled goods. On November 20th, fighting broke out when a French patrol boat attempted to seize a Chinese junk that had already cleared Vietnamese customs. High-ranking French and Vietnamese officers managed to impose a ceasefire the next day, but the French authorities in Saigon had already decided to force a showdown. General Jean Valois, the French commander-in-chief and acting governor-general, believed that it is absolutely necessary to take advantage of this incident to ameliorate our position in Haiphong. General Louis Molière commanded in Hanoi. He was an old soldier who had previously encountered Vietnamese only as servants or troops in the pre-war colonial army, but he believed that France could live with an independent Vietnam and that to force a showdown would end up in a complete rupture of the March 6th agreement and the spread of fighting to all our garrisons in Tonkin. Valois, however, had already issued orders to Colonel Pierre Debes, who commanded the French forces in Haiphong, to demand that all Vietnamese military forces withdraw from the Haiphong area. On the evening of November 22nd, Debes issued an ultimatum to Vietnamese authorities, calling for all Vietnamese military forces to evacuate the city. Shortly after 10 o'clock the next morning, French heavy artillery began their bombardment of the Vietnamese quarters of the city. The Viet Minh government in Hanoi was not even informed of the ultimatum until after the French had opened fire. That the French could seriously have wished for a favorable reply to their ultimatum is incredible, observed Vice Consul O'Sullivan. French 105 and 155 millimeter artillery, mostly acquired from the United States by Lend-Lease, blasted the Vietnamese quarter, causing heavy casualties among those civilians who had not evacuated the area. Vietnamese fighters stubbornly held out for 2 days before being forced to withdraw. Many of the civilian refugees gathered in the village of Kien An, just outside the city. Yet Kien An offered little protection when Debes's artillery, supplemented by airstrikes and naval gunfire, was turned on the village in what Vice Consul O'Sullivan called a terroristic measure. At least 3,000 Vietnamese were killed in the course of the French operations at Haiphong. Although after Haiphong, war appeared inevitable, both sides hesitated to commit themselves to an all-out struggle. The French were concerned about the safety of French civilians in isolated parts of Hanoi and the weakness of some of their outlying garrisons in Tonkin. Ho Chi Minh and a few other leaders still hoped for a negotiated solution, but the Viet Minh continued to prepare for war. By now, the armed units of the Viet Minh had been expanded and reorganized into the People's Army of the Democratic Republic of Vietnam under Vo Nguyen Giap, a former lawyer and history teacher, and a self-taught military strategist and tactician. A longtime nationalist, whose wife, father, and sister had all died in French prisons, Giap had been a close associate of Ho since the late 1930s. A French general observed that Giap incarnated to the highest degree the traditional virtues of the Vietnamese people, a tenacious energy, patience, and subtlety. In contrast to Ho Chi Minh, who retained the appearance of an old Vietnamese man of letters, he seemed a modern, Europeanized Vietnamese, with his jacket, tie, and soft hat. His full, round face conveyed the impression of a powerful personality. Giap's army numbered less than 70,000 regulars. The best trained were former soldiers of the French colonial Garde Indigène Indochine, former members of military auxiliaries organized by the Japanese, former Viet Minh guerrillas of 1945, some of whom had been trained and armed by the OSS, and a number of repatriates who had acquired military training and experience in France and China. The remainder were young recruits who had joined since the August Revolution. The Tu Ve, or militia, numbered over 100,000, but not all were combat troops, and many were armed only with swords, pikes, and antique firearms. To train the expanding army, Three military schools were established in March 1946 in northern and central Vietnam, where officer candidates received basic infantry training, learned small unit tactics and guerrilla warfare, and were drilled on party theory and doctrine. Each regiment of the Army also established its own basic training school. As in Indonesia, the services of a relatively small number of Japanese deserters proved invaluable in helping the new Army master basic skills and military techniques. Somewhere between 1,000 and 3,000 Japanese soldiers deserted their units during August and September 1945 and joined the Nationalists. A few Japanese joined out of conviction, men who wished to continue to fight for Greater East Asia or could not accept the idea of defeat. Captain Kanetoshi Kobayashi found defeat unthinkable. He could not bear the thought of returning to Japan when so many of his comrades had died for the empire. A larger number of Japanese deserted because they suspected they might have to wait years for repatriation to Japan, or saw no economic future for themselves there, even if they did return. Others had married or were involved with Vietnamese women. Some Japanese had been in Vietnam before the war and desired to stay. Mr. Takahata, a Japanese businessman in Hanoi, had been called up for army service in 1944 and served as an army translator. Following the Japanese surrender, he had joined the Viet Minh and become a company commander. Japanese officers and NCOs trained Vietnamese in the use and maintenance of weapons, small unit tactics, and communications. Specialists provided training in field medicine, staff work, and administration. Junior officers were trained in company and battalion exercises. The Japanese introduced the Vietnamese to the guerrilla tactics they had intended to employ against the superior Allied invaders in the last months of the war. Japanese advisors aided in planning and sometimes led Viet Minh forces in battle. Nguyen Thi Thuyet Mai, a former Viet Minh fighter, recalled that her platoon had a Japanese advisor known as Brother Hai and had been armed by the Japanese one day after the surrender. A French intelligence report concluded that Japanese cadres, specialists, and instructors were of very great combat value to the Vietnamese. As fighters, they represent the most aggressive and formidable elements among the rebels. There was no shortage of volunteers for the People's Army, but there was a serious shortage of weapons. Even with weapons acquired from the Japanese after the surrender, American M1 rifles supplied by the OSS in the final weeks of the war and other weapons smuggled in from China and Thailand, French intelligence estimated that the Vietnamese had only one rifle for every two combatants. There were only about 1,000 automatic weapons and 55 light-caliber artillery pieces. In December 1946, Ngo Van Chiu's section of 16 men had between them three English guns, two old hunting guns, four French rifles, and one revolver. In his entire unit, only a platoon-sized force of former Japanese-trained Vietnamese auxiliaries, led by a Japanese officer, were relatively well-armed with rifles, a machine gun, and a small mortar. The young engineer Pham Quang Le was appointed head of the armaments department of the Defense Ministry. First priority for the new arms agency was the production of grenades and grenade launchers, mines, and mortars. There was virtually no gunpowder to speak of. The little that came from shells captured from the enemy had to be used for bazooka ammunition. So we turned to another source, black powder, no longer in use in other parts of the world. There was a great need for mortars, but we did not have the means to make them in the usual way. Our workers had to make 50.8mm mortar tubes by hand and from rails. For bigger guns, we used sawed-off oxygen containers. Beginning in the fall of 1946, the Viet Minh began moving their improvised armaments factories to the area of northwest Tonkin, known as the Viet Bac, from which the Viet Minh had originally waged guerrilla war against the Japanese. At the end of November 1947, both sides were preparing for war. General Moliere had about 4,500 troops in Hanoi, plus artillery and two squadrons of tanks. The Viet Minh had over 10,000 troops, of whom about 2,500 were regulars. But the regulars had only about 1,500 rifles, with fewer than a dozen bullets per rifle, a bazooka, and four machine guns. The Tu Ve had about 1,100 rifles for all of its 80,000 militia. The Viet Minh artillery at Hanoi comprised about half a dozen Japanese 75mm guns. Hanoi in early December was quiet, but the atmosphere remained tense. Vietnamese troops and militia began to erect barricades and roadblocks at key points. Adjoining houses had holes knocked in their walls so that fighters could move from house to house without being exposed to enemy fire. The Vietnamese government began to evacuate all civilians able to leave. Consul O'Sullivan recalled that with the passing of each day, there appeared to be fewer Vietnamese left in Hanoi. Many French civilians and foreign residents also began to stream out of the city. Most of the Viet Minh army redeployed to the suburbs. Viet Minh government officials began to sleep outside the city, and one by one the ministries began to move their offices and records out of the capital. Hospitals and clinics were emptied of drugs and medical supplies, which were carted off to the Viet Bac. Along with them went many Vietnamese nurses, pharmacists, and doctors. Even some faculty of the Hanoi Medical School slipped away to join the Viet Minh. Radios, telephones, and generators, even the French Broadcasting System's transmitter, disappeared into the countryside. Students quietly scooped up paper, ink, and even printing presses for the new government headquarters. From the French came a steady stream of demands that the Vietnamese referred to as ultimatums. They began to refer to Molière as General Ultimatum. First, the French demanded that the Vietnamese dismantle their barricades and roadblocks. If they failed to comply, the French would clear them away. The same day, a French officer transmitted a statement that, since the Vietnamese police had shown themselves to be incapable of maintaining law and order, the French would take over that responsibility. 2 days later, on December 17th, came a demand that the Vietnamese militia disarm and that the Vietnamese cease all preparations for war. Ho addressed a final appeal to Leon Blum, the famous leader of the French left, who had just taken office as prime minister. Blum had recently published an article calling for an agreement on the basis of independence with the Vietnamese, and an end to control of Vietnam policy by military authorities or civilian settlers in Indochina. In the meantime, the People's Army finalized its plans for war. Ho asked Giap how long the Viet Minh could hold out in Hanoi should fighting break out. "About a month," Giap replied. Ho dryly remarked that he would be satisfied with a week. Vuong Tua Vu, who, with his political officer, Tran Do, would command operations in the Hanoi area, planned to initiate surprise attacks on key points in the city with five battalions of the People's Army reinforced by about 9,000 Tu Ve. They would do as much damage as possible to French forces and installations in the city before withdrawing to the suburbs. One People's Army battalion and most of the Tu Ve would remain behind in the Sino-Vietnamese quarter for a final stand. The men and women of the Tu Ve, who had been left behind to defend Hanoi, most of them young, had only pistols, grenades, and about one rifle for every two combatants, plus only two light machine guns and little spare ammunition. Most lacked any type of combat experience. On December 13, 1945, Giap issued final orders to regional commanders for the impending hostilities. By this time, bridges and roads in the Hanoi area had been mined or rigged for demolition. tunnels had been dug beneath the city, and holes had been bored into large trees so that they could receive explosives to blow them down and block the roads. Viet Minh leaders held a final meeting in the village of Van Pho, about 10 kilometers from Hanoi, a place long known for its fine silk weaving. On December 18th, near the market where, decades later, busloads of 21st-century tourists would crowd in to shop for bargains, the Viet Minh made the decision to begin what would become a 7-year war. A little after 8 o'clock p.m. on December 19th, the power supply in Hanoi was suddenly cut. General Moliere ordered an aide to phone the power station. The aide's call was taken by a Vietnamese. The Viet Minh had already seized control of the telephone exchange. "What do you want?" demanded the operator. "I want to find out why the lights went out," said the aide. "That's the least of your worries," was the reply. Two Ve units attacked French positions throughout the city. About 200 French and foreign civilians were taken as hostages, and a few were brutally murdered. The Vietnamese attacked the French military mess at the Hotel Metropole, the French High Commissioner's office, the Paul Dumay Bridge spanning the Red River, and the Shell Oil Storage Facility, along with other targets. They attempted to isolate the French troops stationed in the citadel by bringing in a large train loaded with rocks and all sorts of debris. They stopped it where it blocked all the crossings. Well, one of the French officers happened to know how to run a locomotive. While the citadel garrison traded shots with the Vietnamese, the officer climbed aboard the locomotive and moved the train clear of the crossings. Throughout northern and central Vietnam, French garrisons came under attack. The old imperial capital of Hue was garrisoned by a battalion of 21st Colonial Infantry under Colonel Lacoste. The battalion, with a total strength of about 750 men, held out against the Viet Minh during a 47-day siege. According to one story, Colonel Lacoste's fiancée, a beautiful young Frenchwoman, had been captured, raped, and brutally murdered by the Viet Minh. This made the colonel an even more determined defender of Hue. In the course of the fighting, the entire French section of the city was destroyed, along with most of the Vietnamese neighborhoods. Bridges were blown, and the imperial palace of the Nguyen dynasty reduced to rubble. The siege was finally lifted by the arrival of a battalion of the 23rd Colonial Infantry, though some reports attributed the liberation of Hue to a battalion of the French Foreign Legion. The French High Command, according to this account, withheld the true story in order to give credit to the French units. South of Hue, where the coastal road to the port of Da Nang wound through the mountains, the Viet Minh were reported by the French to be entrenched and, from the vantage point of the mountains, come down to harass convoys and blow up bridges. Da Nang itself was described by an American correspondent as a completely deserted village, except for the military. Exploding grenades and small arms fire is heard in Touraine, or Da Nang, almost nightly. In spite of the heavy guard around the city, the Vietnamese get inside the lines and toss grenades into the areas where the French soldiers are billeted. In Hanoi, heavy fighting continued. The Paul Dumay Bridge, which connected Hanoi with Haiphong and with the nearby airfield at Xai Lam, was briefly occupied by the Viet Minh, but their satchel charges failed to do much damage, and they were driven off by French armored cars and tanks. On the second day of fighting, the French mounted an attack on the Governor General's palace, the headquarters of the Viet Minh Central Committee. But the Central Committee, along with leading Viet Minh government figures, had already left the city. At the palace, Lê Gia Ding ordered his Tuve company to withdraw while he remained behind with an explosive to detonate as the French entered the building. The explosive was a dud, but Lê Gia Ding continued to hold out, eventually accounting for 10 French soldiers before his death. Lê Gia Ding became a hero of the revolution. A street in Hanoi is named in his honor, and in 2000 he was posthumously awarded Vietnam's highest military decoration. On Christmas Eve, the Viet Minh opened an attack on the Zia Lam airfield, which, with the road to Haiphong blocked, remained the only way for French supplies and reinforcements to reach the embattled capital. Viet Minh assaults on the airfield were repulsed, but the Vietnamese on the periphery of the field managed to shoot down several French fighter bombers. The airfield continued to operate, however, enabling French transport planes to bring in needed supplies. On some days, there were as many as 150 landings at Zia Lam. The bulk of the Viet Minh forces had by this time pulled back east of the citadel to the Vietnamese-Chinese section of the city, known as 36 Steps. This was an ideal area for defense, with narrow winding streets, many ending in cul-de-sacs. Each house in the quarter was a fortress in itself, recalled a French officer. The quarter had to be recaptured house by house and block by block. A French attack on the quarter on December 27th failed, at a cost of 45 casualties. In the midst of the fighting, the quarter's Chinese restaurants remained open and did a brisk business. Valois believed, as at Haiphong, that the solution was more destruction. He ordered Molière to hit them hard with cannon and bombs in order to crush the defenders and to prove to our adversary the overwhelming superiority of our capabilities. Molière ignored Valois' bluster. He knew that the Chinese government was already strongly protesting the French use of heavy firepower against parts of the city where thousands of Chinese civilians were trapped by the fighting. In mid-January, the British, Chinese, and American consuls arranged a short truce, which enabled about 6,500 Chinese and Vietnamese to leave the 36 steps. It took the French some 60 days to retake the quarter, at the end of which about 2,000 Viet Minh fighters escaped from the city via a tunnel. The last-ditch defense of the area had been carried out by the Capital Regiment, composed of about 1,000 male and female militia fighters. It included a children's guard of 8 to 12-year-olds, recruited mainly from children orphaned during the severe famine of 1944 to 1945. By the time the last Capital Regiment combatants withdrew across the Red River in mid-February 1947, the Children's Guard had suffered casualties of close to 35% dead. While French forces in Indochina were struggling to open roads and reestablish themselves in the cities, the fragile peace in Indonesia was also unraveling. The Netherlands interpreted the Linggadjati Jati Agreement to mean continued Dutch control pending the establishment of the United States of Indonesia. The Republic interpreted it as de facto recognition of their independence. Each side accused the other of violations of the agreement. As the French had done in Vietnam, the Dutch in Indonesia began to make demands for increasing concessions from the nationalists. Unlike the Viet Minh, the Republic actually attempted to meet many of these demands, but the Dutch were still unsatisfied. To Dutch leaders, the Republic appeared disorganized, fractious, and violent. There was a good deal of truth in these assumptions, but the Dutch then went on to draw the problematic conclusion that most Indonesians would welcome the return of law and order as defined by the Netherlands. In any case, the cost to the Netherlands government of maintaining a large military force in Indonesia was becoming prohibitively high. In order to offset their military expenses, the Dutch needed access to the rich natural resources of Republican-held Java and Sumatra. On July 20, 1947, the Dutch government ordered its armed forces on Java and Sumatra to carry out a police action to restore order in Indonesia. In reality, the police action was a full-scale military operation involving three divisions on Java, and three brigades on Sumatra, with tanks, armored vehicles, and aircraft. The military offensive was partially a product of Dutch impatience with and contempt for the Republic, but also an expression of the Netherlands' desire to secure firm control of the parts of the Indies that produced the most lucrative export products. Lieutenant General Simon Hendrik Spoor, commander of the Royal Dutch East Indies Army, was supremely confident. A charismatic leader and one of the youngest generals in the Dutch Army, Spoor had spent World War II as an intelligence officer at MacArthur's headquarters. A great admirer of the American general, Spoor had adopted many MacArthur-like mannerisms and gestures. If a photographer or reporter was present, then he would straighten his back and put on his dark glasses. At first, the course of events seemed to bear out Spoor's confident predictions. Dutch armored columns easily penetrated the Republican-held portions of Java and Sumatra. It took Spoor's forces only 2 weeks to secure...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.